Today's scripture focus is in the Gospel according to John in the third chapter, the first eight verses of John 3. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Just so you'll know, new microphones have been ordered. I think Nicodemus would have loved this worship series about going deeper in our faith, deeper in our relationship with God. He was all about trying to go deeper. Nicodemus is one of my all-time favorite Bible characters. I preach about him a lot, so I apologize. I looked back, and I actually just last December had a sermon about him as well, but he's great. I love him. I resonate with his curiosity. I resonate with his desire to know and to have it explained and to go deeper. He knows that Jesus is something, but he doesn't know what it is, and he wants to figure that out. And so he goes to him and he asks, and Jesus sees his curiosity, sees his desire, and takes him deeper. He says, "If you want to see the kingdom of God, you have to be born from above." Nicodemus says, "All right, that's all well and good, but take me deeper. I know it doesn't mean literally born again, but what does it mean? What are you talking about here?" And Jesus says, "You have to be born of water and the Spirit. What is born of flesh is flesh. What is born of spirit is spirit." And Jesus' response to Nicodemus leads us to our phrase of the week as we are going through the baptism service and coming across those different phrases that our baptism service uses. This week is baptism. In baptism, we are given new birth through water and the Spirit. It's almost a direct quote of Jesus here in John chapter 3. This new birth that we are given is a part of baptism. The other 2 weeks, by the way, we're talking about baptism as being initiated into Christ's holy church. And then last week, being incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation. Those were our focuses for the last 2 weeks. We have those sermons on our YouTube channel. If you want to get caught up to where we are today in baptism, we are given new birth through water and the Spirit. What is it to be born anew? What is it to be born again? That phrase is fraught with meaning, and for some people it actually has negative connotations. For some people it's just a mystery. For some people it's a profound spiritual experience. Just a very unscientific poll on my own Facebook page last week revealed dozens of different ideas that different followers of Jesus have about what the idea of being born again really means. What is the new birth? Well, the first question to ask is, why do we need to be born again? Have you ever gotten a message on your computer that says something like, "You're basically out of luck with this computer. There's a virus on here that is so deeply entrenched." One of my favorites that pops up is fatal error. Have you ever had like fatal error? And man, I always panic a little bit when that one comes up. You get a virus on your computer, on your phone or whatever, and so you update your antiviral software and run another scan, and that doesn't work. So you turn it off and back on again, which always makes you feel like an IT expert. I turn the thing off and unplug it and plug it back in. But it doesn't fix the problem. It's still there. It's still infected. So you finally call someone who knows what they're doing, and they take a look at it, and they say to you, "Sorry, there's nothing that you can do. You've got to wipe the hard drive clean and start over again." Oh, it's devastating, right? Because you lose everything when you do that. Well, I think that's actually a pretty good metaphor for what it means to be born again. We got to wipe the hard drive clean and start over. You see, the way we're programmed, that is, the way we're created, is in the image of God. Scripture tells us that and assures us that in the initial creation, we are made in the image of God. And we know from Scripture what that image of God looks like. No, we don't know God fully, but we do know that the image of God is, for example, fully loving and gracious. That the image of God is perfectly just and merciful and compassionate. We know that the image of God is perfectly relational and perfectly free. So we know what the image of God looks like. We know that's our initial programming. We know that's how we're made. But we also know that that image of God has been corrupted, and it's not with computer viruses. That which corrupts the image of God within us is what we call sin. And there is no quick fix here. Sin has so corrupted the image of God within us that just updating our antiviral software is not going to work. Just turning off and back on again is not going to work. We have to be born anew. We have to be reborn. We have to wipe the hard drive clean and start over from the beginning. We must be born again in order to reclaim the image of God in which we are created. So what does that look like? How does that happen exactly? It happens by the grace of God. And when John Wesley talks about this new birth, he talks about it in terms of our senses being awakened to the presence of God. He actually compares it to the new birth of a newborn baby who, until the moment of their birth, has been in darkness and can see nothing, has been in relative warmth and comfort, and even the sounds are muted, and all of the senses of the baby in the womb are lessened and dulled until the baby is born. And then all of a sudden, it is really bright out here, y'all, and it's loud and it's cold, and I don't want to be here. Thank you very much. Rah! That's what it means to be born, to have your senses awakened to the world in a way that you never imagined possible. Wesley goes on to say, it is the same with one's spiritual birth. Your spiritual senses are awakened to the world in a way that you never thought possible. And it can be bright, and it can be loud, and it can be a little scary from time to time to see the world as God sees the world, and to see the presence of God in the world in a new way, in a way that is currently unimaginable to you. He talked about that, by the way, in a sermon, several sermons about the new birth that are available to read online. Search for it. He's very clever with his titles. This one was called The New Birth. So you can search for the Wesley sermon called The New Birth and read all about how our spiritual senses are awakened. I've experienced that. I don't know about you, but I've experienced that in life, not in one singular moment, but in several. For example, one moment, I was in Guatemala with a group from seminary, just outside of the city of Chichicastenango, Guatemala. We were on a hill overlooking the city. We had walked up there to see this space in the woods up there. It was a worship space where the people gathered for worship. And when we got there, there were no people there, but they had been there just a few minutes before. We could tell that because the fires were still kind of smoking and smoldering. We saw the fires. We also saw the crosses, the objects of Christian worship that were there for them in that moment of worship. But we also saw scattered on the ground feathers and chicken bones that were charred and had obviously been burned in that fire. And we realized when our guide told us that what had happened in this place was this kind of mixture of traditional native spiritual practices and Christianity in this moment of worship that they had made real for them in their experience of the divine. And as I just stood in this sacred space seeing the evidence of what had just happened just minutes before, I was impacted very deeply. I was born anew. I was able to see an aspect of God that I didn't know even existed, much less had experienced in my life. I was able to perceive something quite different and outside of my own understanding. It was one of those moments of being born anew, having my senses awakened to the reality of God in a new and profound way. So that's how a new birth happens. Our spiritual senses are awakened to the presence of God in new and different ways. So what does that life look like? What after this birth happens, what is the new life all about? What kind of a life are we born into? Well, whatever else a new birth means, it means a radical change in status for the one who is born anew, a radical change in status. You see, over life, we tend to accumulate stuff, not just actual literal stuff, although we do our fair share of accumulating that as well. I also mean here that we accumulate our own biases. We accumulate our own prejudices, our own perspectives. We accumulate our own life experiences, and all those accumulations tend to narrow our perception of the world, to define how we see things and who we are. We accumulate stuff over our life. It's not good or bad, it's just neutral. It's what happens as we live. One accumulates all of that which makes you yourself. When you are born again, when you are born anew, you lose all that you have accumulated over that time. You wipe the hard drive clean and you begin again, fresh, new, a new start. You begin living a new life, a different life, a life that is lived, as we say, in Christ. And what does that life in Christ look like? Well, it's a brand new thing. It's totally different than anything you've ever experienced before. 2 Corinthians 5, if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. It's not just tweaking. It's not just tinkering. It's a new creation. It is made new. Everything old has passed away, continues. See, everything has become new. It is a birth of the Spirit. And so this life, this birth of the Spirit, is lived in the Spirit. And we know what a life lived in the Spirit looks like as well. Galatians 5 makes that clear as it lists off the fruits of the Spirit. A life lived in the Spirit will be marked by love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, which is what it says in Galatians 5. But how I learned it as a kid was love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Anyone? Anyone? Okay. A couple of people are with me on that. It's a great song. You need to learn it. But the fruits of this, or you can just look in Galatians 5. The fruits of the Spirit, the life that is lived in the Spirit, will be marked by these things. You will be able to recognize the new birth because you will see love and joy and peace. You will see one who is patient and kind and generous, one who is faithful, gentle, and one who is in control of themselves. This new life into which you are born, experiencing the new birth. And here, this is the kicker. This is the good stuff. This is the good news. That new life into which you are born, that's your true life. That's the life you were supposed to have been living all along. That new self that is born in that moment, that's your true self. That self that exists within you and just is wanting to be out there living a life in Christ. That's your true self. A life lived in Christ, a life marked by the Spirit. Colossians 3 makes that clear. So if you have been raised with Christ, it says, seek the things that are above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth, for you have died. You have died. And your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. You will be revealed. Your true self, the self that God has always intended you to be born anew, is to be born as your true self. I got to take just a minute to brag about this congregation and how many wonderful people there are here who have experienced that new birth, who've experienced the grace of God and have committed to live that kind of life, because people notice that. People notice the generosity and the faithfulness and the goodness Just last week, I was over at Council of Churches at the Ozarks. I had a meeting at noon on Wednesday. And after that meeting, as I was walking out, Susan did a great job leading that meeting, by the way. And then as soon as I was walking out, the Council of Churches of the Ozarks staff was sitting there eating lunch. And I knew about half of the people who were sitting there, about half of them were strangers. So I peeked my head in. I said, "Don't want to bother you if you're working, but just want to say hi." And they invited me to come in. So I walked in, and Mark Struckoff, who's the director of Council of Churches and a good United Methodist pastor, said, "Hey, this is Andy Bryan." He introduced me to the people who I didn't know. "This is Andy Bryan. He's one of the pastors of Campbell United Methodist Church." And the people that I didn't know like lit up like, "Oh, Campbell. I know Campbell. Those people are awesome." And then over the next 30 seconds, they listed off like six people by name who they worked with in various ministries in our community. Now, I'm not going to tell you who they named because I don't want people to, you know. But without even thinking about it, they listed off by name several Campbell people who get it, right? Who have chosen to be born anew and are living a different kind of life, a life of service and generosity and faithfulness. And my heart just swelled with pride. And I said, "Yes, I am one of the pastors at that particular church." In fact, one of the people that I didn't know that I was meeting for the first time after that conversation, she said to me, "You know, you may have just gained a new member." And I said, "Well, come on over. We have good time. So we'll see." I did my part. I did the invitation thing. So when I got here, I got to put one of those glass beads in the baptismal font. So we'll see what happens. Many born-again Christians need to be born again, again, and again, and again, and again. And that's the good news of God's grace. It can happen as often as we need it. Poet E.E. Cummings said, "We can never be born enough." Love that. We can never be born enough. This day, this moment, this opportunity, remembering our baptism, celebrating what baptism is, may we be born anew, born of the Spirit, born into the life that we've always been intended to lead. Would you pray with me, please? God, you change us with your grace. You work within us to create us anew, to give us new birth, to renew the image of God within us. You change our love of the world into love of you. You change our pride into humility. You transform passion into meekness. You change hatred, envy, and malice into a sincere, tender love for all. God, you change us by your grace. And today we pray for that change, for that transformation to happen, so that we might be born again, again, and become the people that you have always intended us to be. We love you and pray all of this in the name of Jesus and by the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen.